हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम बैक टू माय क्लास. दिस इज़ मैजबिन फातिमा, टीचर एट एलिबेथ हाई स्कूल एंड जूनियर कॉलेज. टिल नाउ वी हैव कंप्लीटेड फोर चैप्टर्स इन अवर सोशल स्टडीज सब्जेक्ट ऑफ सेवेंथ स्टैंडर्ड. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट फिफ्थ चैप्टर, दैट इज़ यूरोप. इट इज़ अ कॉन्टिनेंट विच इज सो वी ऑल नो अबाउट यूरोप दैट इट इज़ अ कॉन्टिनेंट विच इज़ एंटायरली लोकेटेड इन द नॉर्थ हेमिस्फीयर एंड मोस्टली इट इज़ लोकेटेड ऑन द इन द ईस्टर्न हेमिस्फीयर. नाउ लेट्स बिगिन विद अवर चैप्टर. So in this chapter, we will try to find out about how the people of Europe have been using their distinct natural environment and resources. So we'll be learning about how the people of Europe continent are using their distinct natural environment and this and its resources. So firstly, we need to know about the location of Europe. So there is an ocean at the north part of this Europe. And this ocean separates the two continents, Europe and North America. About 500 years ago, the people of Europe discovered the sea route to America and millions of Europeans migrated to the continent of America and settled down there. So, this ocean is separating the two continents, that is Europe and North America. And about 500 of years ago, the people of Europe, they have discovered the sea route, which is from the Europe to America, and by discovering that, many of these people, they have migrated to America and they have settled down there. This sea separates Europe in the north from Africa in the south. The name of this sea means middle of the world. Do you know why it is called by this name? In ancient time, the people of Europe did not know about other continents like America or Australia. They only knew about Europe, western parts of Asia and northern parts of Africa. You can see that all these regions are situated around the Mediterranean Sea. That is why Europeans thought that this sea was in the center of the world and named it so. It has been known by this name ever since. So there is a sea which is separating the Europe in the north and Africa in the south, and the name of this sea means the middle of the world. So why do you think that it has been given this name? So it is because at that time the Europeans, they did not know about other continents like America and Australia. So they only knew about the Europe continent and western parts of Asia and northern parts of Africa. So because of this, they thought that this sea was the center of the world, and then they named it as the middle of the world. So since that time, it has been called with the same name. Now let's learn about the mountains, plains and rivers of the Europe. Europe has several snow-covered mountains. The Alps, the most important mountain ranges of Europe, are covered with snow all year round. So Europe is having the several snow-covered mountains, means almost all the mountains of the Europe, they are covered with snow, and it is throughout the year. The Caucasian mountains, which lies between the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea, from the southern boundary of Europe, they too are very high and covered with snow all year round. So there are the Caucasian mountains, which is lying between Caspian Sea and Black Sea. They are from the southern boundary of Europe and they too are very high and they are also covered with snow. There is a lot of difference between Asia and Europe. We can see many plateaus in Asia, but there are no large plateaus in Europe. There are only some small plateaus in France, Germany and Spain. There are vast plains in Europe. Eastern Europe is a vast plain which stretches across several countries like Russia, Ukraine, Poland, Belarusia, etc. These plains experience heavy snowfall and bitter cold in winters. When the snow melts in summer, small streams start flowing. They join to form mighty rivers. It is from these plains that rivers like the Dnieper and the Volga originated. So when we are comparing Europe and Asia, we can see there is a lot of difference between these two continents. When we take Asia, it has many plateaus, but in Europe, there are no large plateaus and there are only some small plateaus in France, Germany and Spain. And there is a vast plain in Europe. And these plains, they are experiencing heavy snowfall and bitter cold in winters. When the snow melts in the summer, small streams start flowing and they join the mighty rivers. European rivers are used not only for irrigating the fields but also as major waterways. Ships and barges ply on these rivers and transport people and goods from one place to another. Since these rivers flow across several countries, they also facilitate international trade and transport. In respect to this, the Rhine is one of the most important rivers as it flows through several countries and empties itself into the north. So Europe rivers, they are not only being used for irrigating the field, but they also play the major role in waterways, ships and barrages. They also play major role in waterways and ships, and ships and barrages are plying on these rivers and transport people and goods from one place to another place. And these rivers, they are also facilitating international trade and transport. And when we will see this, Rhine is the one of the most important river as it flows through several countries and it empties itself into the north. Unlike the Rhine, the Volga drains into the Caspian Sea, which is a vast lake. Transport to the open sea through the riverway is not possible. Thus, the cities on the Volga are not linked to transcontinental trade through waterways. So, unlike Rhine, the Volga drains into the Caspian Sea, which is also a vast lake. And transport to the open sea through this riverway, it is not possible. So, the cities and the Volga, they are not linked to transcontinental trade. Let's see about the distance from the equator. The region near the equator remains warm all round the year. As we move northwards and southwards away from the equator, it gets cooler and cooler. Indeed, the polar regions are covered with ice all round the year. So when we will see about the distance from the equator, the regions that are near to the equator remains warm. And when we will move towards northwards and southwards, away from the equator, it gets cooler and cooler. It is why? Because the polar regions, they are all covered with snow throughout the year. Let's see about the Atlantic Ocean. The climate of Europe is influenced by another factor, the Atlantic Ocean and the winds blowing from it. This impact is felt more by the regions along the Atlantic Ocean than the ones which are far inland. In the winters, it is quite cold in Western Europe, but it is even colder in Eastern Europe. Thus, countries like Poland and Russia have severe winters, while France and Great Britain are comparatively warmer. Russian winters are also so cold that the rivers and the nearby seas freeze. However, this does not happen in the countries of Western Europe that are located along the sea coast. So when we are seeing about the climate of Europe, it is influenced by another factor, that is the Atlantic Ocean, and the winds which are blowing through this ocean, this is impacting more by the regions along with the Atlantic Ocean. And in the winter season, it is quite cold, and in the winter season, it is quite cold in Western Europe, and it is even colder in the Eastern Europe. Thus, countries like Poland and Russia, they are having severe winters, and the countries like France and Great Britain, they are comparatively warmer. Let's see about the Western Lies. Winds blow all the year round from the Atlantic Ocean towards Europe. Since they blow from the west, these winds are called Western Lies. These winds are warmer than the land temperature and are moist too. The climate of Western Europe is affected by these warm and moist winds all year round as they blow throughout the year. So winds, they are blowing throughout the year from the Atlantic Ocean towards Europe. As they blow from the west, these winds are called as Western Lies. And these winds are warmer than the land temperature. And they are moist too. And the climate of Western Europe, it is affected by these warm and moist winds throughout the year. Let's see about the four seasons of the Europe. In our country, we have three seasons, winter, summer and rains. However, most European countries have four main seasons. They are winter, spring, summer and autumn. To look of the land changes according to the season and the agricultural routine changes too. The transformation of a place over these seasons can be seen in the pictures given. Okay, so in our country, we know that we are having only three seasons, that is summer season, winter season and rainy season. But when we are taking such countries like Europe, it is having four main seasons. They are winter season, spring season, summer season and autumn season. So according to the season, the look of the land will also change, and according to that, the agricultural routine will also change. Let's learn about the four seasons of Europe. So first one is winter. As November approaches, it begins to get cold. December onwards, it gets very cold and snow begins to fall once in a while. It snows heavily on the mountains and less on the plains. The sun shines once in a while. The sun rises very late in the day. It at about 9 or 10 o'clock and sets by 4 o'clock in the afternoon. The overcast sky makes it even darker. Broad-leaved trees shed their leaves in winter and stand entirely leafless. So as soon as the month of November will approach, it gets very much cold, and December onwards it gets too much cold that snowfall will begin once in a while. And it will snow heavily on the mountains and less on the plains. The sun will shine in a while. The sun will shine once in a while and the sun rises very late in a day. At about 10 o'clock, the sun will rise and it will set by 4 o'clock. And the trees starts to shed their leaves, and the trees, they will stand entirely leafless. Now, let's see about the spring season of Europe. The landscape begins to change as March comes. The days get longer and the nights get shorter. The snow begins to melt and new shoots appear on trees. Fresh green leaves appear and colorful flowers bloom everywhere. Lush green grass begins to grow on the pastures. The fields are ploughed in springs and sowing is done during this season. Wheat, rye, barley, corn, sugar beet and oats are the principal crops. So in the month of spring, the landscape, it will begin to change as the March will approach. And the days will get so much longer and the nights will get shorter. And the snow, it will begin to melt and new shoots will appear on the trees. And the trees will start blooming with flowers and green leaves. So, in this season, the fields, they are ploughed and sowing is done in this season. And there are some main crops in this season like wheat, barley, corn, sugar beet and oats, etc. Now let's see about the summer season. It is summer from June to August. It does not rain much and there is more sunshine. The days are longer than our country too. The sun rises as early as 4 o'clock in the morning and sets after 8 o'clock in the evening. In fact, in the northern countries like Sweden, the sun does not set at all. These countries are called lands of midnight sun. Nevertheless, it does not get very hot. This is because the sun does not rise high on the sky and remains close to the horizon, where the earth and sky seem to meet. Summer is the season of agriculture in Europe. Crops mature in this season. There is no need for irrigation as the occasional showers are sufficient for the crops. At the end of summer, the crops are ready to be harvested. So, summer season will start in the month of June. So, summer season will start in Europe from the month of June to the month of August, and it will not rain much as there is more sunshine and the days, they are longer than our country. And the sun will rise early, like 4 o'clock in the morning, and sets after 8 o'clock in the evening. In fact, in the southern countries like Sweden, the sun does not set at all. So that is why these countries are called as lands of midnight sun. So in the month of summer, the agriculture in Europe. So summer is the season of agriculture in Europe, we can say. And crops will get matured in this season and there is no need for irrigation as occasional shower or occasional rainfall will be enough for the crops to grow. And by the end of this summer season, the crops are ready to be harvested. Let's see about the autumn season of Europe. The climate changes once again in September and October. Trees' leaves turn red and yellow and begin to fall. Agricultural operations are wound up. Hay is cut and dried for feeding farm animals in winter. Grapes and other fruits are plucked and used for making wine, jams and juices of various kind and preserved in other forms. So the climate of Europe will change again in the month of September and October. So this will be the autumn season for Europe, and leaves of the trees will turn into red and yellow in color and they start shedding from the trees, and agricultural operations will be wound up and hay it is cut and dried for feeding the farm animals in winter, and grapes and other fruits they are plucked and used for making wine, jams, etc. And they are preserved in other forms as well. Let's see about land and agriculture. European plains and rivers valleys are very fertile. It rains here all through the year, and the rivers also do not get dried up in any season. As a result, the plains are highly suitable for agriculture. However, a large part of Europe is mountainous and not suitable for agriculture. Some countries have very little agricultural land. For example, only 3% of the land in Norway is available for cultivation, and 30% of England is cultivable, while in Germany it is about 40%. This is very different from our country. In India, as much as 55% of the land is cultivable. So European plains and river valleys, they are very fertile, and it will rain here throughout the year, and the rivers, they do not get dried up. As it is raining throughout the year, the rivers will not get dried up, and as a result of this, the plains, they are highly suitable for agriculture. But the large part of the Europe, it is covered with mountains, and it is not suitable for agriculture. And some countries have very little agricultural land. For example, 3% of land in Norway, it is available for cultivation, and 30% is available for cultivation in England. And when we will see Germany, it is about 40% of land which is cultivable. But when we will see our country, India, we are having 55% of land which is cultivable. Let's see about the agricultural revolution. Europe was, like Asia, a continent of small farmers and landlords. However, over the last two centuries, this has changed so drastically that only a very small section of the population practices agriculture, and there are no small farmers as in India. This happened due to technological revolution, which enabled farmers to cultivate large tracts of land with very little labor. Machines, chemical fertilizers, etc. came to be used extensively in farming, and the product of farming was now mainly for sale in the market. At the same time, large land owners and capitalists took over the agricultural land from small farmers who abandoned agriculture and took employment in the cities, in industries or other services. So when we will see Europe, it was like Asia, which is a continent of small farmers and landlords. But over last two centuries, this has been changed drastically, that a very few small section of the population is practicing agriculture in Europe. And this has happened due to the technological revolution, which enabled farmers to cultivate land, tracts of land with a very little labor. And due to usage of machines and chemical fertilizers, and due to this heavy usage of machines and fertilizers, farming and the product of farming was now mainly for sale in the market. And at the same time, the large landowners and the capitalists, they took over the agricultural land from small farmers, and these farmers, they have abandoned agricultural and they have moved to cities for employment. Let's see about European farms today. Most of the cultivation in Europe is carried out in the large farms, more than 50 to 100 acre in size. Generally, farmers build their houses in their own farms. The farmhouses are usually very large and have a number of rooms for different purposes, sheds of animals, godowns and storing grains, coops and sties for poultry and pigs. So most of the cultivation in Europe, it is carried in a large farms, and more than 50 to 100 acres in size. So generally, farmers, what they are doing, they are building their houses in their own farms, and the farmhouses are usually very large, and they are having number of rooms for different purposes, such as sheds for animals, godowns for storing grains, coops and sties for poultry and pigs. These big farmers hire laborers to work on their fields. They also use heavy machines like tractors and harvesters. Almost the entire product is sold in the market. Sometimes the farmers also hire machines from nearby cooperative societies. So these big farmers, they are hiring the laborers to work on their fields, and they are also using tractors and harvesters in their fields. And almost the entire product which has been produced, they they are using it for selling in the market, and sometimes these farmers, they are also hiring machines from the nearby cooperative societies. Large holding and mechanized farming enable European farmers to earn a good income. They live in comfortable houses equipped with modern amenities. They use gas and electric stoves for cooking. About 50 years ago, most European farmers baked their own bread. Now they sell off most of their produce and buy their bread from the market daily. Several varieties of bread and cakes are available in nearby towns. Fish meat, which is an essential part of French diet, is obtained from poultry, cattle and pigs of the farm. Meat is also preserved by smoking, drying and freezing. All houses have larders or cellars to store meat, cheese and wine. Now they are also stored in large cold storages. The farmers obtain most of the things of their requirement from the nearby towns. Besides bread and other food items, they also obtain agricultural tools and machines from nearby towns. So the large holdings and mechanized farming has enabled the European farmers to earn good income, and they are living in the comfortable houses which is having modern amenities, and now they are using electric gas and electric stoves for cooking. And about 50 years ago, the most European farmers, they used to bake their own bread, and now they are selling off most of their produce and buy their bread from the market daily. And presently, several varieties of bread and cakes are available in the nearby towns. And all the houses of Europe, they are having larders or cellar to store meat, cheese and wine. And now they are also storing and now they are also stored in cold storages. And now the farmers, they are also obtaining agricultural tools and machines from nearby towns. Let's see about the modern agriculture. In Europe, agriculture is practiced as a commercial enterprise just as industry. The farmers make his living by selling their entire produce and getting all of their requirements from the market. The agricultural technology they use also require the use of hybrid seeds, chemical fertilizers, pesticides, etc. So, in Europe, the agriculture is practiced as a commercial enterprise, we can say, just like an industry. And the farmers, they are surviving by selling of their produce and getting all the requirements from the market. And the agricultural technology which they are using requires the use of hybrid seeds, chemical fertilizers, pesticides, etc. However, when we are comparing Europe to our country, very few of Europeans, they are dependent upon agriculture, and most of them work in industry or service sector like banks, transport, etc. And even those who work in the field of agriculture are helped by the government with a lot of subsidy to carry on farming, as it gives them less income than other kinds of work. The government pays them for carrying on agriculture in the villages. So even those who are working in the fields of agriculture, government is helping them, and the government is also paying them for carrying on agricultural activities in the village. Let's see about the discovery of sea routes. About 500 years ago, the West European sailors and traders began to search for new routes to India. This was because both the routes mentioned above passed through countries ruled by the Arabs, who were often at war with the Europeans. Further, most of the trade in the Mediterranean Sea was controlled by Italian merchants who did not let in traders of the other countries. That is why the sailors of the other countries began to look for routes to India that did not have to pass through the Mediterranean Sea or the Arab ruled countries. So about 500 years ago, the West European sailors and traders, they began to search for the new routes which are towards India. And this is because both the routes, they are passing through the countries which are ruled by the Arabs and were often at war with the Europeans. And further, most of the trade in Mediterranean Sea was controlled by Italian merchants. That is why the sailors and the other countries began to look for routes to India. Of course, the maps did not exist in those days. The people had just begun to figure out that the earth must be round and not flat. An Italian sailor named Christopher Columbus thought If the earth is round, then it should be possible to reach India from the west too. If we were to travel to westwards across the Atlantic Ocean, we would reach China and India sooner or later. So, at that time, the maps were not present. So, the people just began to figure out that the earth is round in shape. And there is an Italian sailor whose name is Christopher Columbus. He thought that if the earth is round in shape, then it should be possible to reach India from the west part of the world too. And if we were to travel westwards across the Atlantic Ocean, then we would reach China and India sooner or later. So this Columbus, he sets out with three ships in 1492 to cross the Atlantic Ocean. After 3 months of sailing, he saw land ahead. Columbus thought that he had reached India. Actually, he was still far from India. He had reached the country which we now call the West Indies. These are a group of islands near America. In fact, Europeans did not know of America before Columbus. In a way, he stumbled into America. Soon, Europeans realized that Columbus had not reached India, but a new unknown continent. After all, several Europeans went to America to trade, conquer and settle there. So, Columbus, he set out with three ships in the year 1492 and he crossed the Atlantic Ocean. And after 3 months, he saw the land ahead of him. And Columbus thought that it would be India. But actually, it was not. Today, we are calling that land as West Indies. So, he reached that land and he had discovered that there are other continents also. So, at that time, Europeans, they did not know about other countries like America. And then the Europeans, they have realized that Columbus did not reach India, but to a unknown continent. After that, several Europeans, they went to America to trade, conquer and to settle there. The ships of those times had sails to harness wind power. They sailed with ease with the winds blowing westwards towards America. Were they the westerlies? No. They were not the westerlies which blew towards Europe. These were different winds which blew from the south of Europe towards the southwest direction. They blew throughout the year and took ships from southwest Europe to the east coast of America. They are called trade winds. So, ships of those times had to sail with harness and wind power. So, they sailed with ease with the winds which are blowing from the westwards towards the America. And these winds, they blew throughout the year and took ships from southwest Europe to the east coast of America, and they are called as trade winds. After Columbus, the Europeans discovered several sea routes. They could now sail not only to America, but also in different parts of Africa, India and Australia. They traded with these countries and amassed immense wealth which was used to develop countries in Europe. So, after the Columbus sailor, the Europeans, they have also discovered other sea routes also, and they could sail not only to America but also to the different parts of Africa, India and Australia, and they have traded with these countries, and the wealth which they got from trading from these countries, they have used it to develop industries in Europe. This was all about our fifth chapter, that is Europe. I think it is an interesting continent. So, let's continue our next chapter with next class. Thank you.